Hello everyone, good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited about this public lecture for two reasons. One, of course, it is going Good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited about this public lecture for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited about this public lecture for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited about this public lecture for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited about this public lecture for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us today. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited for two reasons. One, of course, it is good afternoon and thank you very much for joining us. As we begin the public lecture today by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, Director CDFD and a very, very senior scientist and a close scientist at CCMB, for the lecture today on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present, we are excited for two reasons. Yes.
Trichum.
Hello. Hello. We will start in a short while. This is a trial. We will start in a short while. Hello. Hello.
We are not locked in YouTube or anything. Just check once, mostly now.
Raghu is saying that they can, I mean, he's on YouTube and he can hear me on loop.
Zoom also, there is some problem on screen.
Zoom
screen. Yes, sir. But sir said some sound is there, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the public lecture by Dr. Kumarasamy Thangaraj, senior, a long time senior scientist at CCMB and director CDMT. And today's lecture will be on ancient DNA, a genetic thread that connects our past and present. We are excited about this public lecture for two reasons. One, it will of course tell us the public, the Nobel Prize 22 winning work of Professor Svante Pääbo, where he used ancient DNA to understand the genetic relationship between Neanderthals and humans. But it will also tell us, the talk today will also tell us how ancient DNA research started in India and actually more specifically at CCMB itself. Dr. Thangaraj has seen this journey from very close quarters at CCMB himself, and we expect to hear all of those stories and more in this talk today. So with no further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Vinay Nandikuri, Director CCMB, to welcome and introduce our speaker for the evening. And at the same time, I would also like to tell the audience here that talk will be for 45 to 50 minutes, followed by addressing your questions. Vinay, over to you.
Hey. It's a pleasure to introduce Thangaraj. I've known him for quite some time. He actually did his PhD from the University of Madras and joined CCMB almost 30 years ago now, in 1993, as a postdoc and scientist at that time. And over the period of all these years, I'm now currently the director of CCMB for the past 2 years. He is somebody whom I knew well before I came to CCMB, and he became the director of CCMB. And what I know of him is one of the nicest people that you will ever meet. In his scientific journey, he has done exceedingly well. And he's a fellow of all three academies, the Jesse Bose fellow, and he's also got a Baxi Award and many of other things along the way. But what actually is endearing about Thangaraj is his personality and the way he looks at science and the kind of things he has done. Personality-wise, you won't see as somebody who's basically neither than him in one sense, or rather a person who's completely not lacking by anything around him. And scientifically, he has done some brilliant work, which he's going to talk about now. And it's published in, the scientific work is published in pretty much all the big journals that are there in biological sciences. And finally, this is an area which is identified with him, which is a big deal. In India, he is the guy. When we start talking about this kind of an area, you think of Lalji Singh, of course, but Thangaraj for sure, you identify Thangaraj with the area, or Thangaraj and the area are synonymous. So that's what any scientist can look for, and that's what Thangaraj's science is all about. And he continues to do this work, and he's going to share his experiences and his thoughts on this topic. Welcome, Thangaraj.
Thank you. Evolution, school, college. Of course, you don't forget the name.
Just know it. And when you talk about evolution, you always remember about Darwin. He wrote a book in the year 1858, the title of the book
is
The Origin of Species.
Various mention about
origin of almost all the organisms, right from arch to A. But what was missing in that book was that how the human mind of arginate.
There's another
evolutionary biologist, Thomas and explained in 1863, he wrote a book called Evidence as to Man's Place in Nature. In fact, he was the first one to talk about the human evolution. And based on the anatomical similarities, probably human must have passed from ape or
any other non-human primates.
Later, in the year 1871, Charles Darwin wrote another book called The Descent of Man. And there he declared that humanity and gorilla are
of course, now with the
availability of genome sequence based on the anatomical features, still established that the human and chimpanzee have diverged from the common ancestor called hominins. But still, people think that probably they are not evolved from chimpanzee or gorilla. Even some of the responsible, they say that nobody has seen chimpanzee or gorilla turning to man. It's not that magic that chimpanzee within a few minutes or hours turning to human. millions of years. And another is a genetic change that brought a different phenotype in the way we look at. But on the evolution, there is a damage genetics behind that. So to look at what happened during the last 60,000 years when we diverged from the common ancestor called hominins. But before that, even somebody thinks that we probably might not have diverged environment from human like hominins. But look at the three brothers for one year of our parents. And also, if I have example from this, the original is not there, like they were in one of the circle company in Bangalore. They were 5 years and I had a company. I met them personally, but I did not have an example because the circle owner felt that there is something happening to the place in the other way. Otherwise, you would have some insight into genetic basis. Some of the genes which are involved in bringing our anatomical features and correct way. There are a few more examples. Look at this the features and the body from hair and more darker. Look at the hair. So the features which we have lost during the course of the future. But the same features appear again, it's a backing region. So God is back like so I mentioned about genetic cases for all the genes. There are genes. Particularly, look at phosphine 2, that is essential for our speech, and there's a gene called myosin gene that has created more space in the skull and therefore the brain size has space. So, there are several other genes that we identified which are having a mutation which are present in our human brain. So, there are two amount of changes which help the human. So coming back to the question of divergence of human humanity from the common ancestor, I mentioned that it happened 6,000 years ago, and there are several species which have evolved, and almost all of them are disappeared. For the sake of seeing much closer, I have put two panels. And look at the species which have evolved and disappeared in the last 6,000 years. There are three distinct features we have gained in the last 6,000 years. The one is the ability to walk in 2 years, unless by currency. The second one, the ability to make foods for survival, roughly like a planting for food. Third distinct feature is increase the brain size. At the early species, chimpanzees, the brain size was as similar as chimpanzees. Then in Australopithecus, brain size was 35%. In Homo habilis, 60%, Homo erectus, 60%, and other species. And interestingly, for those species, of course, related to the future. Neanderthals. The brain size was slightly bigger than one. We don't know whether they're intelligent or not. But this species is no more.
And interestingly, there are few hypotheses.
The other hypothesis why species disappeared was that one of the evolutionary biologists from Cambridge. One class in this year in 2006, when I have my say that inherent violent behavior of modern people maybe this one will follow. Then, if you look at where this Neanderthal is existing, they are mostly found in Europe and some part of Middle East. All of these, almost all of these have been studied now. And this is the cusp of the area of the very first fossil realized as Neanderthals. The first Neanderthal remains were found in Belgium there in 1830 and in later in the year 1848. And the one which was found in Neanderthal Valley in 1856 was the one which has been taken into genetic studies. And if you closely look at the Neanderthal skull, and there were again few speculations based on the morphological comparison, was predicted that the Neanderthal were the direct ancestor of modern European. That's what they do, let's say, incomplete data. And probably they contributed some genes to modern human, and they were completely replaced by modern human. These are contributing very easily to all these different sets. And this thing, as I mentioned, ancient DNA has grown last many three decades. The problem with ancient DNA is that the DNA generally can be isolated from the fresh tissue or blood, it's still intact DNA. But if it is a very old, it is in a different environmental condition, it undergoes a different kind of damage, which I mentioned here, strand break, accidental lesions, DNA crossing, and academic lesions, and so on. So ultimately, the battery reduce the DNA side. As a base substitute and so on, which makes very difficult for anybody to arrive. Clearly, extracting DNA itself is struggling from such a legacy. When you look at any animal death or preservation, you cannot see in that band that I mean, you see very little on the DNA, but you see
also.
And this just shows that how the DNA is isolated and the entire process. Get the bone, actually, the bone from here, jaw, and the source of the DNA. And of course, the pulp and the grinder, small, the motor which grinds that bone or inside the food. Take about powder, and this process is not transferred for all the material from the material. But I say DNA, then overall, the original sequence, you may find, but after a very long set of DNA, maybe partial DNA, or you can amplify specific region of the right. Once you get the DNA sequence, then
assemble with the human or other species, and you can come to the conclusion.
The contamination is another major issue. The mark, the chair, the bone, the air, any kind of management are there. So that is going to affect the ultimate analysis. The human DNA, so that's the DNA of. Exogenous DNA from outside and the contamination. But once you isolate DNA, then you can use adapter specific to either to the human or another to
used it for analysis. And this is the very first
ancient DNA study which has done. And he took the sample which I mentioned from Germany, 1856, was how. And he amplified the mitochondrial DNA. The entire mitochondrial DNA is 16,500 base pair. And it consists of hypervariable regions, or control region of the group, consists of hypervariable region 1 and 2. And you see four variations in this region, is mostly they're all intact after the cloning or the plus the DRNA gene, and then more in the line conserved, they're not so much variation. This is the non-coding region, which so far the variation that was used for the analysis. And then the sequence, these are the DNA sequence, two different DNA sequence shown here. The DNA is there about 4 nucleotides, 39.19.95%. And if you look at these two, wherever there are dots, again there's a place where there's a difference between these two. This case there's a G, other one has A. There's a G, A here, and there's a G. There's A and G. So the variation. That's the reason this hypervariable region are used for the region. And he has taken the right profile of the Neanderthal, cut that, and drilled and excavated the DNA, and this is the sequence, partial sequence, two different, very short sequence, which now will be considered because of the technology. Allows us to do the whole process. Using the hypothetical metal line, they published that in the study and shown that there is a divergence between the Neanderthal and our human for 59,000 years old. And if you look at the time divergence, all will happen about 100 years. Then, at that time, he was in Munich, Germany. He moved to that rank school of evolutionary anthropology in Germany. And there, he started a consortium for the Neanderthal Genome Project. There were many collaborators, including where he has started looking at the whole genome. Therefore, those the first one to have the next generation sequence. Therefore, in collaboration with them, they try to amplify and extract the whole genome of the Neanderthals. And they are studying 38,000 year old Neanderthal fossil that was being from the modern group, which is because they are isolation, there's no contact with modern group. So that made easy for them to analyze. And the sequence and they found that the comparison with the human and chimpanzee genome, the primitive modern human and Neanderthal have diverged about 5,000 years. So this is the one paper which came the year 2006. But this is another paper from Nature Digital Science by another group where some of the Pääbo also was published. This is published in Science, and their divergence period also for the same. Two different studies looking at the Neanderthal confirm that the divergence period is almost the same. And there was a write-up about this by take a number, because after I now moved to Australia, and he wrote comparing both the technology and they used biosequencing, and here they used human probe capture and growing, capturing, and sequencing. And here is the whole genome sequence, and they are doing assembly using the human sequence. That was a partial sequence. And in the year 2010, on carbon 2, and A2 came Neanderthal DNA from four different caves. The sequence on the four different biological samples on the Neanderthal, and they have compared that with five human genome sequence. They are from Africa, the sign and Yoruba, Papua New Guinea, and Chinese, and the French from different and they say that the Neanderthal genome is partially existing in people who are out of and it's coinciding with the way they have formed the Neanderthal, they are mostly in Europe. In the East, Africa, and again, we're not finding here. But interestingly, we also found another species, which probably close to Yuan and Neanderthal. That was found in the cave. It's called human. Neanderthal, this is the diagram here, approximately 500,000 years ago. Then the Denisova, called Denisova, about 1 million years ago. Then they also used additional Denisova material as a tool. And they say that they have designated this as a zone in the study. So that means two other species which are not found yet are, of course, in the law, but the zone was not found yet. And they have given the name. We have also looked at the Neanderthal and Denisova DNA and its proportion in the modern forms. And this study actually led by David, where Pääbo is part, they are also part of the study, and they have shown in the Neanderthal ancestry, there are 300 individuals from all over the world. And this is 0 up to 3%. The Africans doesn't have the Neanderthal genome. Whereas people who move out of Africa, there are up to 3%. And if you take the Denisova, and they are very particular in this Southeast Asia and also near. That will find 5%. In addition to what he has shown about the evolution and its relationship with the one human, he saw his work with the Neanderthal, we continue to do any other aspect. And this was an aspect of the whole chain. If I can analyze and see how the genome which we have inherited from Neanderthal next, if two worlds are susceptible to conformity, are gain resistance to the core. So in this study, we look at chromosome number 3, and we found about 50 manages inherited from the Neanderthals, next the usual, particularly in South Asia, was susceptible for. In fact, he looked at patients from UK, particularly the Bangladesh population. And he compared the frequency of the mutations found of the three, the South Asians are having 50%, whereas the Europeans have 60%. So it meant that probably the increase of frequency in the mutation may be making the people more susceptible for COVID, because most of the patients are the ones are actually down. But when we look at the frequency of those mutations, then we didn't find frequency is almost in our case except in so one hand we say that something is more susceptible to COVID, and here is it is giving resistance, but now we find frequency is almost the same in both in case of Asia, Europe, and also except so that gives some kind of contradiction. Then in the recent issue of science, they found a single amino acid in this gene, EKDR1, lysine and arginine, which makes actually having response for neuron and the expression in the fetal human neocortex is high in developing frontal lobe of modern human, that is leading to more neuron in the human, modern human, and the Neanderthal. So, the mutation in the course of mutation dimension, compare Neanderthal and human, there's a one base. But one amino acid chain, everyone is different to the level, brought to such a difference. Now I'm coming to this prediction that Neanderthals were the direct ancestors of the world. In another study, we have looked at in a large consortium three different ancient epochs. One from Mokala, one set of samples from Tucker, other one from Luxembourg. And we found that the origin of Europeans was considered that Neanderthals are probably the founder of the European population. Whereas we have shown that indigenous hunter-gatherer is one source. Many Eastern farmer who probably migrated to Europe around 1000 years ago, probably must have taken agriculture, is another second source. The North Eurasian was technically tied with Europeans and North Americans are the third source. So again, there's no Neanderthal contribution directly to the Europeans. And interestingly, this also gives different perspective in terms of understanding how we know that we are born. The happiness is started based on 100% the beast doing more than 1,000 attacks. And after we start eating parts with food, the amylase gene comes and does the one. Then the skin color. Second, everybody would think that from migrated from Africa, why some populations are in that skin color. India we see great skin color. Right. So that happened because of the nutrient pressure. Somebody in Europe don't see the sunlight for several months. Sunlight is essentially a part of the high melanin factor, then the light is not sufficient. Therefore, there's an inflation to lose the essence of the heat, which gave the skin color light. So that happened after people start migrating from the farm. That color you have seen in almost all the European. The third one, very interesting. The lactate resistant gene, which the lactate is a red sugar, which everybody can digest when we are eight, that is very active. And as we go forward, initially, but not now, we must have. Is problem in the milk after the animal. That is why nutrition tools which help to digest the sugar and even then we have to have it. So that nutrient which are these small samples are saturated from the milk. That started around 5% of the first. We don't see the nutrition is present today. Which probably happened around 5,000 years, are not present in the 7,000 articles in the world. So, we also look at how the disease spread in America was a issue with any other disease. You can still see the sequence of those patterns. So, that helps us.
Understanding how the people were there. So in that
aspect, how CCMB has contributed to human digital language. This one of our early study that we looked at one price, and we see both the mitochondria can explain it here. And we have shown that the Andaman tribe
probably
are the first modern human migrated out of the plantations of the coast from the plantations, Andaman and Nova, and that's about 65,000. The first generation. So the Andaman tribe are the first modern human who migrated out of Pakistan.
The same issue.
Science. Another group studied population called monarchs from Malaysia. And they have also come to the conclusion, and there was a writer, the same issue, reporting for the paper, some of the paper, that this is the most probably way of human migration. Is still holding true. Now I'll tell you some of our other findings using ancient DNA aspect.
There's a place called Dupu that's in Himalaya about 5,000 feet high in the Himalaya.
And this lake consists of large amount of water. for the first time, the Anthropological Survey of India, they have excavated about 50 to 60 years back. And this same is frozen all the time, except maybe the 2 weeks in the summer. Yes. Otherwise, it's all the time frozen.
There are a large number of moon samples.
And a lot of speculation about those moon samples. What are those bones? And who are they? These are some of the speculations. One is the ancient traders probably were migrating to that. So perished due to some natural disaster. The second speculation is Gurava Singh's army of Jammu who tried to invade Tibet the year 1841. The third one, King Chakravar and Kamut, his wife and they and the attendants who were going to that for maybe vacation or something like that. And some natural calamity happened and they all perished. Next one is victims of endemic pestilence. That's about 5,000 feet above sea level. Somebody has to go now. They have to stay in what places, provide themselves, and be a safe. Last one is victims of interesting suicide. Only as a mass and get to that place. But actually,
nobody knows what was the reason.
Our own colleagues from here and some of the collaborators from Deccan College, they went and collected the samples. And this sample, and you can see the location where it is being on the map. The carbon dating series, there are two different time points of the sample. One is around 800 days old, and one is 1000. We must have two different time points. And the and we found that there are three distinct groups. One group is very close to our living in area. One group like the group we have to and another only one sample reflects Southeast Asia. So we came to the conclusion only where the material people who are climate, we don't know why they are.
It is addressed one issue that they are
not the one which are listed earlier, but there are somebody that we don't know why they are not there.
The second
study which I want to highlight is that you know that there are harbors, that there's a simulation, part of simulation that we can. And there was some
intact
skeleton from one to two here. And there are many of our collaborators doing their CCMB. Sequence of work, you know, of course, there are some gaps. And what we found
in the study was that
the carbon sample consists of two different. A small proportion of the anatomies and large proportion of the Iranian undergatherer. All the Iranian farmers, Iranian undergatherer, this sample itself is not visible about 2000 BCE. And this, of course, more than 10,000 BCE. Again,
important in this field. The next one is again it's a
very big study. Using one of the largest studies using 500 more samples from both South and South Asia. And we found that this sample also is not very open. And they are closer to the MIA study positive. And probably they are the ones who took the interlocal language to Leo from 2005 BCE and brought to India also. They have a very small proportion. It's only in the last part of South. And it's not very, very old, it's around 2000 BCE. It's a very recent study. Just highlighting that how the technology is used. It's a place called Achala, Punjab. There's a large number of bones that are found on them. They are identified, they are soldiers. The question is, who are they? They are any found the region, or they have come from America, use again. Sequencing the DNA, Y chromosome, and also part of the autosomals. And found, and this is a based on the mitochondrial axis and not based on some of the signatures. Found in the skeleton of Thangaraj. Because locally, Punjabis, Punjabi, and this is the KNK, Central and South. And when you look at it, particularly the frequency of these signatures, it is not exactly the same, Punjab, more, Pakistan, even more, and come to the KNK, and start to naturally. Not people who migrate to there, recruiting the army, and they have been taken to the army. So it helps us in identifying who are these people. And finally, I wanted to tell you about how identifying the remains of King Edward has taken it to different directions, and towards the end we will see how it has helped at higher level. So there's a small video, although I have video for the root wound, I did not play that, but I want to just give you, so this will give you the background of this bone.
Queen Ketevan, great granddaughter of King Constantine of Kartli, ruled over Georgia in Eastern Europe. In 16, Ketevan, the emperor of granddaughter Shah of Constantine of the Safavid dynasty, ruled over Georgia, conquered her Europe. In 1631, the emperor and granddaughter Shah of Constantine land of the Safavid dynasty of Jordan conquered her great granddaughter of King Constantine of Qatar. The emperor and granddaughter Shah of Constantine land of the Safavid dynasty of Jordan conquered her great granddaughter of Shah of Constantine of Qatar. The emperor and granddaughter Shah of Constantine land of the Safavid dynasty of Jordan conquered her great granddaughter Shah of
If you mute it, what is happening?
Queen Ketevan, great granddaughter of King Constantine of Kartli, ruled over Georgia in Eastern Europe. In 1613, the Emperor of Persia, Shah Abbas I of the Safavid dynasty, conquered her lands and threatened to destroy Georgia. But the queen, to protect her subjects from annihilation, surrendered and was taken prisoner in 1614. She remained a prisoner of the Shah until 1624, during which attempts were made to convert the queen to Islam and force her to join his harem. Both bribes as well as torture were used to persuade her to relinquish her Christian faith. Queen Ketevan, however, withstood all the attempts and was finally killed on September 22, 1624. Her death is also mysterious, as one account says she was crucified to a tree, while another says she was strangled. Legend has it that a light appeared on her body and the Patriarch of Georgia declared her a martyr and saint. The story, however, doesn't end there, and it is believed that two Augustinian friars, her confessors, discovered her remains in Shiraz and brought them to Goa in 1627. It is these relics, her right arm and hand, that have come under attention, as it is believed that they were buried in the chapter chapel of the Augustinian convent and may still be there.
The search for Saint Ketevan's relics started in 1989. However, efforts in earnest began in 1998 when the Catholic Patriarch of Georgia wrote to the Ambassador of India in Ukraine seeking permission to search for the relics of the Queen in Goa. Subsequently, a Georgian delegation, which included a bishop, came to Goa but failed to locate the remains.
Silva Rego relied on the manuscripts of Augustinian friars written in 1817, 1723, and 1629, and in them in a scientific manner described in detail the tombstones in the church floor, the side chapels, and the chapter chapel.
Using archaeologically sound techniques, the ASI have cleared the ruins and in their labors have recently chanced upon the most likely resting place of these relics.
This is the second window on the epistle side of the altar of the chapter chapel, above which, according to the book on Silva Rego, were once entombed the remains of Queen Ketevan.
Entombed in the black box, along with Queen Ketevan's remains, were the relics of Fray Guilherme de Saint Agustin and Father Jerónimo de Cruz. The ASI came across remains of the black box and a longish bone fallen below the second window. Can this bone be the right arm of the saint?
Yeah, that was the question, whether this bone is the right arm of the saint. That is because the ancient government wants to take back the bone. So the archaeological surgeon here brought a small piece of bone and we started working on it. And if you look at the picture, and you compare it, that shows a unique signature in the mitochondria. And if I compare whether that signature is present in our collection of 22,000 of Indian mitochondria, we did not find very unique in any part of India. That's one evidence. The second evidence, the SPR profile, and the called amylogenic, and expressively at the voices. And this time we found that we have female control in the control, we not find male specific The third one is we requested the Archaeological Survey of India to get some sample from Jaya. So they brought 30 samples. And after that, two of them showing the same signature of the report sample. So there are three and one. We did not find 50,000 of the samples. And also, two of the key people from Georgia matching with the signature of the one which we found in the bone sample. Of course, that we published long ago. But interestingly, what happened in the recent
bone sample, part of that particular has been handed over by our who is from the past of the camp. That happened in the past. So you can imagine what kind of applications the technology has. And then why they have to like for that? And something that initiated very first. Bones. I didn't stop with that. Was continuously working on that. And there is no solid publication. There are many reasons. One is the copy number. Who copies it? It's a UTH, one is the copy of UTH, one is the mother. Well, the mitochondria is multiple copies. Multiple mitochondria is different. Multiple mitochondria DNA is different. So, that's like two copies versus hundreds of copies. That's one. It's a circular DNA fragmentation that is bad compared to DNA. And it is maternally DNA. Based on maternally DNA.
Very nice, very
So our earlier papers, we have shown clearly
ancestor identification, because we don't have any distinct signature saying that the identification. One of our papers is showing here. It shows that there are two founding populations for India. One is ancestor South India, was part of the early human migration, and the other one is for migrating some who came in southern part of India, who are the ancestors of India. Second way brought people in for not the other ancestors, not India. And there was admixture between these two groups. Other than that, we didn't see any distinct migration. You can say that there is an alien invasion and they have to people from north to south.
I heard once that the change in skin color in European people is a result of an instinct of identification. Is that for like the genetic mutation from that?
So, what is the first question?
I heard that the change in skin color for European people is a ingrained of identification.
No. That inbreeding has happened only in a particular population. That can lead to any kind of disease, even some of the skin related diseases. But in general, if you look at Europeans who are light in color, they're all because of the mutation in this one particular case, SLC25A, which reduces the light pattern becomes.
I have one question. If physical changes in an animal's life doesn't really influence evolution, how did Europeans become lighter in color? You said that they became lighter in color because they did not receive sun for months together. How did they become lighter? How did they?
Okay, anyway, so I resume your question. In the early human, because it happened around 5 to 6 thousand years back, and that gives advantage equal to survival. So that probably dominated. Whereas those doesn't have mutation have lesser disadvantage, so therefore they have probably disappeared. There are many mutations which are helpful for the society for better survival. It's not that every individual got one individual got and got missed because it was 5 to 6 thousand years. I mean more than that. Yeah, when you compare India versus Europe, the disadvantage here. Because why the skin has not grown, we won't have a very preserved sample for that because of the shopping plan. So, whatever the bone sample we get, they are very decent. If the old ones, several thousands of years old, must have become automatically destroyed. It's no well preserved. That's one reason. Second one that what is the opportunity to do that? The opportunity is that this field not many people are working, right? And that mainly because of the interest. And you compare the scientists, most of the fields, special scientists working in the lab. Given this opportunity, that I don't think many people will try to go to the field, get sampled and work. So these are some of the issues why the field has not gone. One is that I have to get a sample that the actual field does.
Even for the Neanderthals, they say that they can change, they do
All right, let me consider that as the last question for the evening. And shall we have a round of applause for Dr. Thangaraj? Thank you very much. And also thank you all very much for coming here for the lecture today and enduring all the glitches and the rains that had to